Welcome, everyone, to the Jack Westin MCAT podcasts. This is our second episode. Super excited. I'm one of your hosts, Zaya Calderon Muniz, and here with
Phil Hawkins, the MCAT director at Jack Westin. I feel like now that we're on the second podcast, it's officially a podcast, right? Before it was just like a video. Now it's a series, right? So we have a series now because we're on the second one. So super excited about that. Last week we talked a lot about memory and the way people learn and how to learn and how to optimize your learning better for kind of like long-term stuff. And we started to touch a little bit on like people's mental state as we're going through. And so we're gonna continue that. We're gonna talk about stress. And I feel like Azai, you inherently must be living a more stressful life than I am. Knowing like what I know from having gone through med school, that was easily the most stressful period of my life. Just so much stuff going on all together, all at the same time. But you are nearing the finish line of your first year, or in the short rows, as my dad would put it, as a farmer. Because as you like harvest a field, you go around in circles, keep getting smaller. Mm-hmm. So when you're in the short rows, you're at the end. There's a little bit of farmer lingo for those of you. I know that's why people actually, you know, tune in for this podcast, is to get farmer lingo. But you're in the
that's
short
why rows. I tuned in.
During the end. Yes. Yeah. How's your stress level?
Variable. it definitely depends on if it's an exam week or not. And I can definitely chat about that. But I don't think I mentioned it last time. So I'm a non-traditional student, first generation undergrad, first generation medical school, Spanish literature major. So wasn't even a bio major, just all sorts of outside of the usual. But also, I actually had to take a year off halfway through medical school, just for personal health reasons. And so I did the first half of medical school back in 2019, and then time off, and then came back to school in the middle of a pandemic, not having talked to patients in over a year, not having studied science in over a year, right? All of the things that I had learned slowly draining out of my mind over those months. Mm-hmm. And I mentioned this during the last podcast, but it really has become my motto moving forward: progression, not perfection. And I think that's helped mitigate a lot of the stress that I've been experiencing, because I would be lying if I said that I lived a stress-free life. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you can definitely relate to that.
Absolutely. And I actually wanted to address, like last week when you talked about the like progression instead of perfection thing, like in the back of my mind, I could see a bunch of pre-med students going like, that's stupid, I want to be perfect. Mm-hmm. And like, I'm certain that that's probably how I would have felt at the time. And I'm sure maybe you would have felt that, like, you know, a couple of years ago, like, I'm going to be perfect in med school. But like, imagine being a physician, or like as a doctor for like a couple of weeks, and being expected to be perfect in everything related to medicine. That is impossible. Being over your head is the default state for pre-med students, or and medical students and students in residency, or doctors in residency. Being over your head is the default position for at least a couple of years. And so I really like that idea of progression and not perfection, of like seeing the growth and focusing on that. That's like now that like ties into a bunch of stuff that I want to say, talk about with motivation, but like, that's not what we're talking about today. Today we're talking about like stress, and I want to address, like, there's some different kinds of stress. There is, there's lots of ways to dice up stress into different types. There's acute stress, which is, oh my gosh, that's a bear. And chronic stress, which is like I'm in med school, or like I have trouble paying the rent, or like I have a kid who has special needs, and that's like really stressful because I'm worried about them getting picked on in school. Like, that's chronic stress versus I'm being attacked by a bear, which is acute stress. And your body responds to those stressors differently, right? Like acute stress, that's the whole sympathetic fight or flight thing. Long-term stress or chronic stress is more of a cortisol-based thing. And cortisol is a super interesting hormone because it does all sorts of weird, strange things that are counterintuitive and a lot of times just not helpful. And like, it doesn't seem to make sense. But once again, I feel like, oh man, talking about evolutionary pressures 2 weeks in a row, and we're only 2 weeks in. But if you look at cortisol from like a evolutionary perspective and like stress from an evolutionary perspective, if you think like, what is a caveman like stressed about, right? Like throwback to last week. What am I and Sally and Oog, what are we stressed about? It's not taxes are due. It's not, I have a test coming up. It's not med school's hard. It's food, right? Like I am stressed because I don't have enough food, right? And like, there's not enough food and winter's coming and all of that stuff. So looking at it that way, cortisol actually makes perfect sense in what it does because it has a lot of very strange effects. First off, it makes you hungry, right? And so being stressed will cause people to overeat. It can do some stuff with food regulation. It also makes you increase your blood sugar because if you're starving, you need to make sure that your neurons have the glucose they need because if they die, they don't come back and they're kind of picky on their food sources. So like you'll increase the blood sugar. You also like change where the fat is deposited in your body. You'll start to deposit fat in like the central body, like around your torso, and you'll actually lose fat in your arms and legs. I know a lot of people are like, wait, that doesn't make any sense. But if you're starving, you're also likely to freeze to death because you don't have the energy to like maintain like thermoregulation. And it, like, if I'm gonna like freeze off a finger, like that kind of sucks, but that's a lot better than freezing off a lung or like my liver or something. So you end up kind of like insulating like the central body. So like the abdomen, and you like gain weight there, but your arms and legs actually stay surprisingly skinny because you're trying to just move adipose tissue around in your body because of freezing and starvation go together. And so if you're stressed, you eat more, your blood sugar goes up, puts you at risk of diabetes. It also makes you gain weight specifically in the central body. It also makes you really tired. And that also seems a little bit strange until you realize like if I'm starving to death, I probably shouldn't go for a jog around the lake because I don't have enough energy, right? And so if you're starving, if you're starving and you have like stress, and that's also going to make you more tired. And it also lowers your immune system because your immune system takes a lot of energy to keep up, to like make those white blood cells, to keep those defenses up. And so when you get stressed, your immune system drops. And this is why every year in undergrad during finals, I would just end up like locked in my room. And normally I would eat pretty healthy, but like during finals, like I was just hungry. And so I was eating like crappy food, like Doritos and Dr. Pepper. And I was just like so tired. It was like 3 o'clock in the afternoon and I'm tired. And then I would get sick, and it's all because of stress, right? Like stress, my immune system drops. I got hungrier. I was tired and exhausted. I didn't have the energy to go for a jog or run. And once again, that kind of worked in undergrad. I mean, it wasn't ideal, but I was able to get through that in undergrad. But then once you start dealing with like, because a lot of times in undergrad, it's like a sprint, right? Like I have a test coming up. I'm just going to like eat like crap and like be sick for like a week and then it'll be okay. But when you're prepping for the MCAT, like for 3 months, or you're in med school for 4 years, all of a sudden, like that's not sustainable. Like you can't do that. And I think a lot of times people underestimate the effect of stress. Stress also has a huge effect on memory. There are several research articles out there that show that kids who are raised in stressful environments, their hippocampus is 30% smaller, which is huge. And like the hippocampus has to do with memory. And so like if you are raised in a stressful environment as a kid, then you have a worse memory. And that explains why a lot of kids who grew up in stressful environments struggle at school, because they just have a harder time learning. Your hippocampus doesn't develop as well. And if you're stressed later in life, you actually have a harder time learning as well, which creates this horrible feedback loop of I'm stressed about the MCAT, which makes it harder for me to learn stuff, which makes me more stressed about the MCAT, which makes it harder for me to learn about stuff. And so it's just this like feedback loop that makes things really negative. But it's not all doom and gloom out there, but it is important to kind of understand these and understand how it all kind of fits together, because I didn't when I went to med school initially. And I think I talked about it a little bit last week, but I was like, I didn't have time to eat, like to take a break to eat. And I didn't have time to like, let alone go for a walk or exercise or things like that. I was just like in class or studying or sleeping. And it was just through that cycle. and getting super stressed, and that just made it harder to learn. Things changed. I like got a little bit better, but before I kind of like talk about like the progress and what I did to get better, Zai, you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah. So I actually have a few. One of them though ties in with the changes that we talked about making and how that impacted our ability to remember the information. But I think also, and you hinted at this the last time we spoke, when you adjust your study habits, right, your method of learning, you, in part, you're remembering the information better because of how you're studying, right? But tying in with what we're talking about now, it also decreases your stress levels because you realize, hey, I can manage my time better. I have more time for myself to reset, to do whatever I need to do, and I can still do as well, if not better.
Right.
And that was something
better.
And exactly.
Then that's less stressful, and then that makes it easier to learn.
Mm-hmm. And so for those of you who were listening to Phil talking about this feedback and were like, I'm stressed, does that mean I'm going to like, yeah, you know, go into this never ending loop? No, you can work your way out of it, right? You can, you know, our goal here is to make sure that you're prepared for taking the MCAT, and not just for taking the MCAT, but you're going to have a lifetime of learning. You know, you're going to have a lifetime of tests. If you're interested in being a doctor, you have boards, right? We're here to help you get a strong foundation to do well on the MCAT. A little bit, you know, for medical school, hence we're here chatting about those connections too, and, mm-hmm, you know, onwards. And so finding a way to manage the stress when you're first getting started is beneficial, right? But some of you may have already been studying for a little bit and you're like, I can't restart, you know, I can't undo what I've done the last month or so. You can still change the way you're going about it, improve your stress levels, improve how you're approaching the MCAT. And I think part of that goes into not seeing the MCAT as this awful thing that you have to do that is pointless, useless, and has no function whatsoever. And I think that's a huge misconception. And I was among the students who was like, this exam is pointless, useless. I don't need it. Why am I doing this? Why am I wasting my time, my money, my, you know, my mental bandwidth, emotional bandwidth on this? And I think, you know, you and I have chatted offline about this. But the MCAT teaches you to learn, right? It forces you to learn, but also it's a good stepping stone between undergrad and medical school, because those two are worlds apart. And you've heard us say this, and we're going to keep saying it because it's true. You know, undergrad, the way you go about it is very different than the way you go about medical school. Why? Because if you're interested in being a doctor, you need to remember the information you're learning for when you go see patients, right? You don't want to forget it. You don't want to dump it, because then you have a patient who comes up to you in clinic and they're like, hey doc, like I have this, 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 what do we do? Right. And I think you can definitely touch more on this. If, you know, undergrad is like a 50 and medical school is, let's say, 100, right?
In terms of like difficulty.
Yeah. In terms of difficulty, you know, the MCAT makes it so that you don't have to go from 50 to 100 right away. And so using that as, you know, viewing the MCAT as an opportunity instead of something that you absolutely have to do and hate, you know, can also help with the stress levels, can help break that cycle as well.
Yeah. As somebody who originally took the old MCAT, which was, I mean, it was only a 3.5 hour long exam, which still sounds monstrous until you realize the new exam is like 7.5 hours. The old MCAT did not help us make that like jump in terms of difficulty. Like this is something we've talked about, like going from like 50 to 100. The old MCAT was still harder than undergrad, but it was like a 60. So you jump from like 50 to 60 going from undergrad to the MCAT. And then in terms of difficulty, you go from 60 to 100. And then med school is so much more difficult. And I blame that for some of the reasons of why I struggled that first semester of med school, because I hadn't been challenged in a way where I needed to change the way that I tackled things. But the new MCAT's more like an 80. And so you're jumping from like 50 to 80, and which is a big jump, but then going from 80 to 100, like med school is still as hard as it was, undergrad still the same difficulty, but that like we've bridged that gap. And so all of a sudden the stuff that you're doing for the MCAT helps you with this. And a lot of people talk about how the MCAT is useless and stupid. And like, I know we've talked about, like, we don't really feel that way. And a lot of people point to like a specific topic, like why do I need to know nuclear physics or fluid dynamics? And like, okay, not all doctors need to know nuclear physics and fluid dynamics, but if you're a radiologist, you absolutely need to understand radioactive decay. You absolutely need to understand nuclear physics. If you're a cardiologist, fluid dynamics is crucial for knowing that like if the radius of an artery cuts by 1/2, according to Poisson's law, the flow rate or the blood flow in that artery drops to 1/16th. Of what it used to be. And so all of a sudden fluid dynamics is like critically important. But you know, there's a lot of things going on with the MCAT. I actually think it's a really useful test. And not just like trying to score and help people or like help med schools figure out like who's going to do well in med school, but it's also a really useful tool for helping students to be ready for med school. It's kind of like boot camp. Now, don't get me wrong. Everybody hates boot camp. I don't think there's anyone out there that's like, I love boot camp. I can't wait to go back. Myself included, when I finished the MCAT originally, I was like, I'll never have to think about this ever again.
Yes.
Now it's all that I think about. But yeah, there's a lot of things that it's actually kind of useful for. And so it's not all doom and gloom. It is hard. But I promise you, as you like go through this, you'll get better. This kind of goes in with the like focusing on the progression, not perfection. And so like kind of like making progress. But I do want to talk a little bit about like what I noticed about the students who were really good at this. And I was not at first. And then I slowly got better, or actually I got better kind of in one step, and something that was a little bit weird. But so for my first semester of med school, I struggled a little bit. And then Christmas was coming up. And so my mom, my parents like called and asked like, what do you want for Christmas? And I'm like, I don't know, something awesome, like a kayak or a Great Dane puppy or something. Cause I had a roommate with a Great Dane and she was moving out. And I was like really sad about not having the Great Dane around anymore. Mm-hmm. And so this was on like a Friday afternoon. And, you know, I said, you know, kayak, Great Dane puppy, something awesome, something fun. Cause I'm like stressed out and I just need something fun in my life. And then I called them back like Saturday morning and I'm like, okay, I know I said Great Dane puppy. I don't have time for this in med school. Cancel the Great Dane puppy. Order like go with a kayak or something outdoorsy or something, because I've been trapped inside forever studying. Turns out somewhere between like Friday at 3 o'clock and Saturday morning at 9 o'clock in the morning, my mom had gotten a Great Dane puppy. And so Christmas comes around and my mom's like, we'd already gotten it and we couldn't take it back. Now, if you want, we can kind of keep it here. I think my mom fell in love with it. but I'm like, no, I'll take it. We'll try to make it work, because I also fell in love with the puppy. Some of you guys may see her in the background of some of the like free trial sessions and stuff wandering by. Her name's Millie, after the discoverer of the electron, because I'm a nerd. Millikan being the discoverer. But anyway, so that second semester, all of a sudden, my study techniques were getting better because of some of the stuff that we talked about last week. But also, I had this puppy I had to take care of. And so I had to take her for a walk like every day, and had to take her to the park and kind of like move around, because it's a growing puppy. It can't just like stay in a kennel for like, you know, 60 hours in a row. And so it forced me to get out and start moving around. And like, I think the like changing my study habits helped, but also that like just moving around helped, like getting out of the house, seeing the sun, like vitamin D and that sort of thing. And that helped a lot. And that made me kind of like stop and realize that, like, you know, I wasn't exercising at all for months. And it turns out exercise is the number one way to reduce cortisol. So all the stuff that we just talked about, you know, all the bad problems with cortisol that makes sense if you're starving, but do not make sense if you're stressed about a test. You can fight those off with exercise. And it's something that I noticed with my med school class. So my med school class had this really interesting competitive thing going on where the top five students each semester, their next semester was paid for through a scholarship. And so I didn't have to worry about it because I was MD, PhD, but yeah, I know it's like a super like interesting thing. So it turns out that like, if you were in the top 5% in the previous semester, then this semester is paid for. And so all of a sudden there are a lot of students that are like, if I study just like 2 more hours, I might make $50,000 if I just like study a little bit harder. And, you know, so you'd think it was the people that were just like, nose to the grindstone, trapped in the basement with piles of books around them, like I felt like I was. But the students who were doing best were not those students. The students, like, there was one guy who did an Ironman while he was in medical school the first semester. And there was another guy who ran marathons, and he would run for like at least 7 or 8 miles every day. And there was another group of like 6 or 7 guys that would play basketball, and like guys and girls that would play basketball every day for at least an hour or two. And those were the people that were on the top. And I found myself just like flabbergasted. I'm like, how are these people so smart that they have time to do these other things. One guy went to like volleyball tournaments on the weekends and like traveled around. I'm like, how do you have time for that? I don't have time to eat. But like, I came to realize later, like, no, they weren't so smart that they had time to like exercise and do stuff. They were doing so well because they made time to exercise and do that. And so I think a lot of times people, like myself included, have this like feeling of, I just don't have time to take care of myself. I'll like worry about that later. I need to study and do well in the class. And like, no, that's not how it works. Taking the time for yourself is more important than studying at a certain point. And I think everyone has this idea of like this mind body separation, that like I'll have a really strong mind, but I'll just let my body suffer here for like a year or two. And like that, you can't have a good, like a healthy brain without a healthy body. They're connected. And so making time for like, at least, even if it's just like going for a walk. And so that second semester, not only did I start walking the dog, but like that felt so good that I started walking. It was like 12 blocks to the med school. And I would start walking there, even though it was like February and freezing in Omaha. But it just like, it helped me clear my mind, and like my studies went better. And so all of a sudden things started being better as I go through this. And part of that has to do with the like changing up the study techniques. But a part of it is just because I started to make time for myself. And that makes a huge difference with that, like, you know, the effects of endorphins, like countering cortisol, and you find that it's all of a sudden easier to learn in those scenarios.
Yeah, a lot of what you have shared resonates. I was someone who went through a lot of imposter syndrome when I got to HMS. Like I did, and that's just kind of how it was. And like you, I overdid, and who would have thought that I'd be saying that I could overdo studying, but here I am saying I overdid studying. And I overdid it, quite frankly. I was spending so much time. I wasn't doing the things I love doing anymore. I'm someone who likes writing. I wasn't writing anymore. I love social dancing. I wasn't social dancing anymore. You know, I wasn't making time for my friends the way I wanted to. And that all took its toll. I struggled a lot with those, you know, first few months. And I had, bless their souls, I have amazing friends that I made first year and am making now, I guess, in this second part of first year. And we used to go out and we found this place and we started going social dancing. And so anyone who knows me in my personal life knows that I love salsa and bachata. Like I can't not do it. And I started feeling better and I was starting to get less stressed. And I was like, why am I taking, you know, at least one night a week out to do something that eats so much time? Like, that's not rational, but at the same time, it is. It is because, like you've been talking about, I was, you know, combating that very strong stress response, you know, from medical school. And that was also, it coincided with the time where I started shifting the way I was studying. Mm-hmm. And so all of these things intersected in a really positive way that made it a lot easier to work through. I had a wrist surgery, after all of this had started. I managed to make it through without, you know, really pausing for much of anything. Why? Because I had set up the rest of my life, right, in a way that was conducive to making the most out of the time that I did have. And I think that's something that a lot of people, when you're in undergrad, you know, they're going to be folks who are listening to us who are in undergrad and they're studying for school, right? And then they're also studying for the MCAT. They're going to be folks who are working, you know, part-time jobs and studying for the MCAT and in school. They're going to be folks who are, you know, past that stage in their life. They're just working, they're doing gap year, whatever it is. And so people have different amounts of time that they can allocate to studying for the MCAT. I think it's important to, if you haven't already built it into other parts of your life, build in time to exercise, build in time to self-care into the MCAT studying time, budget it. If you have, you know, 4.5 hours, 5 hours that you can study that day for the MCAT, build in at least a 15-minute break, right? Go for a walk. You've done 2 hours, go for a walk around the block, then come back. And I think that that's going to make a huge difference that people don't realize. I have now started walking. I live a little further from campus now, but I'm also a slow walker. For anyone who knows me, they know that for sure. And I'll leave class and I'll walk home for an hour and I'll cross past the river. And that time, my mind resets. By the time I'm back, I have a quick meal and I'm ready to go back and study again. Because if I went, you know, from class and then just came immediately home, I'm not going to want to keep studying. Like, I'm going to be very frank with you. And so that can also be a way to make sure that you're motivated to come back and study when you do take those shorter breaks for exercise.
Yeah. Especially like if you came home and like watched like an episode of TV for an hour, that wouldn't be nearly as useful as the like that the walk itself, like in terms of like clearing your mind and that sort of thing. And I absolutely like wholeheartedly agree with it. That's why if I'm ever working with a student on creating like a study plan or a schedule or like tutoring or something like this, it's always like you have to have at least one day off a week, at least one. That has to be completely off, that you're not doing anything MCAT related. And a lot of students like buck at that and they feel like, well, I need to be using my time that I have. My test is in like so many weeks. I need to be ready for it. And so I need to use all of my time. Like, no, you like, it actually is better for you. You will learn more if you don't do that. If you don't work every single day for 40 days, you need to take some time off for yourself. Yeah. And I think that that is super important. Now I'm really interested in your social dancing thing, because I also did a lot of swing dancing back in the day in college and in med school.
That's wild. I got into swing dancing in undergrad, when I first came to Boston, I tried to find a place, but didn't really find anything settled upon. And then, you know, COVID happened. But I really do think it's important. And I think also, you know, we've talked about students kind of not wanting to build in those days off, have definitely had these conversations with students. And one of the worst things that you can do for yourself is allow yourself to get burnt out before the rest of your life even starts.
Yes.
Because like we've talked about, if you're listening to us, you're planning on going to medical school, right? You have 4 years of medical school, unless you're doing MD, PhD, right? And then you have all of the other components. You have residencies, you have fellowships, et cetera. Why would you allow yourself, or why would you contribute to burning out before you even get to be a doctor? Wait until the MD comes and then you can, you know, maybe even consider letting that happen.
Right.
But don't cut yourself short because, you know, you didn't want to take a day off during the week. It sounds silly, right? That we're pushing something like this, but it is so incredibly important. You really are playing the long game here. You want to make sure that you pace yourself. And I think that that's, you know, you pace yourself on practice tests, right? You pace yourself on section exams. You might as well pace yourself on the entire thing.
Yeah. It's that progress, not perfection. Mm-hmm. Make sure that each day you're making progress and make sure that it's sustainable. And yep. I always you know, there's all sorts of analogies for med schools, like drinking from a fire hose or eating like so many pancakes. I think that like, I don't know if I love those examples, because in my mind, med school is more like you wake up in the morning and let's say somebody, you woke up and somebody said, you have to walk 15 miles a day. And that's your whole thing is that. And I'm like, I could do that. It wouldn't be easy, but I could do that. I could get up and I could walk 15 miles or 10 miles or whatever it is. Let's say 10 miles. I could do that. Like I have a whole day. I could do that in a day. Now somebody comes up and says, okay, you need to walk 10 miles every day for 4 years. And like, so that changes things, right? It's not that one day of medical school or one day of MCAT studying is too much. It's the marathon, right? The MCAT and medical school both are marathons, not sprints. And at least for me in undergrad, I was like, in the analogy, a sprinter, physically not a sprinter, but in the analogy, yes, I'm a sprinter. And so I would like sprint for an exam and just like study really hard for one exam and then do well on the exam and then just not worry about it. But all of a sudden that doesn't work for the MCAT. That doesn't work for medical school. So you need to make sure that you are, whatever you're doing is something that you can sustain long-term, something that you could like, I could do this for a year. And I think a lot of students don't do that. They like get into this mentality of I'm like, I just have to push real hard for 3 weeks or a month or 2 months or 3 months, and then it'll be fine. I'll get back to normal after this. You need to make sure that studying is your normal. And that is like scary for a lot of people, because the way they've been doing it is not a sustainable way. And so if you tell somebody like, this is what your life's going to be like forever, they're going to be like, nope, out. But like, the key is to change the way that you're doing it. And I think I think this is like the third or fourth time I've said this, but like the progress over perfection is the key thing to like, look at the progress that you're making. Don't focus on being perfect, but the progress. And I think that that goes for pretty much everything. Like if I wanted to look like Arnold Schwarzenegger and be like super buff, and like at his prime, or honestly, even him today would be a step in the right direction for me. But if I wanted to look like, you know, a bodybuilder, if I'm just focused on that end goal and every day I wake up and I look in the mirror and I'm like, I'm not Arnold Schwarzenegger. I'm not Arnold. And then I go to the gym and I come back and I look in the mirror. I'm like, I'm not Arnold. Like if I do that every day for like 3 months or 4 months, like I'm gonna completely lose motivation. Like I am out, right? Like this is awful. Because I'm trying so hard and putting in so much work and I'm not at the goal. But what I need to do instead is to focus on the progress that I'm making. Like before I could only walk for like 30 minutes and now I can jog for 10 minutes and I couldn't even like jog for 1 minute before. And then I can jog for an hour and I can like, just like see that progress. And that keeps you motivated. That keeps you engaged. And I don't think students do that enough especially when they're prepping for the MCAT, because they're always focused on like, I need this score. And they're focused on that. And don't get me wrong, scores are important, but I think it is easier to stay motivated and to stay on top of things if you keep like focusing, like, I understand magnets way more than I did last week, right? Like I'm like so much better. Or I understand fluid dynamics, or I understand like the kidney or Freud or whatever. And as long as you kind of like keep track of that progress, it's going to be a lot easier to maintain motivation and kind of keep up with what you need to do in order to be successful.
Yeah. And I want to rewind just like a few seconds of what you said. You know, you said students tend to get focused on the numbers. Yes, mm-hmm. Because this feels like a numbers game, right? But you can monitor progress in other ways. You know, the score, the percentage that you get when studying is not the only way to monitor progress. Let's say that you're doing one of our, you know, one of the Jack Westin fundamental question sets, right? If you can, you know, maybe you got the question incorrect, but you set everything up correctly, and then it was just a small arithmetic mistake, right? Versus the week before, you had no idea that the equation even existed, or you knew that it existed, but you had no way of applying it, right? Yeah. That's something that only you can measure. The score can't measure that for you. So then you go, you know, you practice the arithmetic a little bit better, and then you're not going to make that mistake come testing. It's also, okay, you know, I'm not doing any practice passages this week, right? But I have been reviewing a lot of material. Let me try explaining it to someone else. Can I explain the topic to someone else with enough accuracy and, you know, clarity that they understand what I'm telling them, right? That's a huge step in the right direction. And so we tend to get focused on the numbers because yes, like you do get a score at the end of the MCAT, right? You can't, you know, you either void it or you don't. But in the time before all of that, right, in the preparation, don't just use the numbers as a metric of progress, because that is the easiest way to, like Phil was saying, look in the mirror and not be happy with where you're at. It really is, you know, this is the long haul. It is a marathon and not a sprint. And so finding ways to keep track of your progress aside from raw percentages, great way to go about it.
Yeah, especially because the way the MCAT tests it's really easy to fall into that trap, because in order to answer, let's say, this question, you need to know about fluid dynamics and cardiology, and you have to interpret this data, right? And like, you have to do all three of those to get this question correct. If at the beginning, like you missed the question, you didn't like know the equation, but like later on, I know the cardiology and I know the fluid dynamic stuff, but I didn't understand the table. Like you made progress. You still missed a question, but you are making progress. And so a lot of times, because the way that the MCAT is designed is that it is always, there's like degrees, the MCAT like adds stuff to questions to increase the difficulty because you guys are too smart and it's hard to separate you. And so like to answer one question sometimes takes like three or four pieces of knowledge or three or four things that you have to do in order to solve this. And like missing, like if you're just looking at the scores, if you missed all four or you missed just one, there's no difference, but that there is a difference. There is a difference in terms of your knowledge and your skill. And so, that's another thing why I think a lot of times for progress, for students' progress, especially depending on what their specific weakness is. A lot of times students will prep for a long time and their scores aren't going up, and they get super frustrated because they're doing that, like looking in the mirror and I'm unhappy thing. And that's why. It's because, like, yeah, they're learning more, but they haven't quite put everything together all into one thing. And so a lot of times you'll see scores, students that are just kind of like flat and plateau, and then all of a sudden will spike. And it's because they finally got to the point where they can put it all together. They've been accruing all this knowledge and skills. And then once they can bring it all together, then they get the questions right. And so, yeah, absolutely. I hadn't really thought about it like that, but that definitely fits into that category of, you know, kind of maintaining motivation, not getting too stressed, taking care of yourself. And hopefully we can set everyone up here for to avoid some of the challenges and problems that we've had. Basically, you all need to get puppies and start swing dancing. Please, please do not do that. And if you can't handle a puppy, don't take one. But yeah, those are actually some of the most important things that I think I did in undergrad to make me more successful or in med school.
Yeah. And, you know, all of this we share with the, you know, benefit of, you know, hindsight, right? Yep. And so our goal is not to make anyone feel like, you know, I shouldn't have been doing this or, you know, let me formulate my words correctly. It's our goal in sharing this is not to make you frustrated with where you're at. It's right. To give you the tools to not make the same mistakes we did. Or if you have started making those mistakes, right, to course correct. And so we are here as your guides, so to speak. But it's understanding that everyone is at a different place right now, but we can all work towards improving ourselves, improving our stress levels, improving how we're studying, and improving our retention and application of the information together. And that's ultimately what we here at the Jack Westin MCAT podcast are hoping to do with you guys.